Pastor Jay Shepherd at Tri-City Baptist Church now for 5 years. I grew up in Fort Myers under Richard Riley. He pastored the Emmanuel Baptist Church years and years ago. I grew up under his leadership all through my high school and my elementary school. I went to his Christian school. And my senior year, right going in before my senior year, he passed away. And Pastor Matt Doerr, the pastor that's there now, was my coach at the time, and my youth pastor. He ended up taking over the pastorate of that church and guiding me my next few years. I went off to school and different things, and through the course of events, I interned at a church up in Georgia and ended up moving down back here and kind of closer to where I was from into Port Charlotte. And Pastor Shepherd had brought me down for the purpose of interning, learning how to start an independent Baptist church. So I came down and I thought, well, I don't know very much. I was out of college, but if you've been to college, most of you know college doesn't teach you very much. The real learning is when you get that hands-on experience in the ministry. So he had to take me from really ground zero of my Christian walk and my Christian faith. I had never led a song before. Pretty crazy. You go to Bible college and you never lead a song. I had never sang a special before. I had preached maybe one time through my college career. So I needed a lot of work. It took me more than what I expected, and 5 years later, well, here I am. So anyways, that was kind of the short story of my life. He's walked me down these roads of leadership and learning how to run a church, and he's let me have the hands-on experience of seeing how when you do it the wrong way and how to do it the right way, and the impact it can make on people's lives. And through that training, which I'm very grateful for now, he's come to the place where it was a few months back, he had called me on a Tuesday night, and he had driven down to Lehi to visit a family that had come all the way up to Port Charlotte to visit our church from down there. And he called me and said, I need to know a church that I can recommend to these people that would be close to their home. And I told him, I know Lehi well. I have family that lives in Lehi, and there's no church within that vicinity to send them to that would be close. You can send them, and I named the churches that they could drive 30 minutes and get to a church that would preach the way we would want them to preach, but there was nothing close. And he said, I tell you what, I want you to pray about starting a church in Lehi Acres, Florida. And I knew as soon as he said it that it really was the will of God. And I'll be honest with you, it took me a while to accept it. I fought the Lord for 24 hours, and I prayed about it, and I told the Lord, the problem is, and I'll be very transparent with you, I have family that lives in that city. So that's a problem. Believe it or not, if you've been in the ministry any length of time, family can be problems. But not just that, I have a lot of unsaved family in Lehi. And the way they view how I run the ministry is the way they're going to view the Lord Jesus Christ. And I was afraid in my mind that I might not do as well as I would hope, and that family would get a bad impression of Jesus Christ. And I fought the Lord for a day, and I prayed and prayed and told the Lord there's a lot of other places I would prefer to go, maybe, that don't have my family as close. And the Lord convicted me about it, and he said, no, it's exactly what I want you to do. So I surrendered to the call, and I told Pastor Shepherd I would go. And ever since then, the Lord has opened door after door after door. And I could tell you so many blessings. And I could stand up here literally and take the entire time with the blessing after blessing of people that have already never met me before, already called me up and said, we want to be a part of the church when you get started. Here's my name and here's my address. And you can't even do those things. There's no way I could explain those things. I had needs that I was praying about that I didn't tell anybody else about. Hymn books that needed to be bought. And a guy took me out to lunch a few weeks ago and said, I'll buy all your hymn books. $900 he gave me towards our hymn books for the new church. I mean, blessing, after opening door, even to the place, I'll give you one more blessing. He gave us our first building. Me and Pastor Shepherd had driven down there for a survey trip, and we looked everywhere. And the downside about Lehi is there's no buildings, no church buildings. There's really not even a lot of storefronts because it's such a highly populated area that as soon as one becomes available, it's sold within hours. You can almost call the people and say, no, it's already off the market. I called one guy, and I told him what I was doing, and he laughed at me, and he said, you can't afford it. And it was just a storefront. I figured, well, it's a small little room. I could afford that. And I asked him how much it was. And he said it was $3,500 a month for a very tiny room. You probably couldn't have fit 30, 40 people in. So I said, you're right. I can't afford that. So I'll keep looking. And through the course of the events, we looked at all these buildings, and it just seemed like a wasted day. We were down there for hours. And the last place we decided to go in was the biggest park in Lehigh, just to see if maybe they had some sort of a room that we could rent for our ministry. And kind of depressed, we kind of walked in there, and the lady said, sure, there's a room you can rent out in the church. So we, you know, were excited a little bit, but we'd been depressed before, so we tried not to get our hopes up. And as she walked us to the back, and it was so miraculous that the whole backside of this recreation center that they have is almost a perfect setup for a new church. And they have a whole its own entrance that you can have our different you know, greeting tables and things at. And they have a whole room that you can seat 100 people. Fully AC, the chairs and tables are provided at no extra charge. And of course, there was a side room for children that already have arts and crafts set up. And then there's a nursery. All three rooms right beside each other. We thought, wow, what a blessing. And we're afraid of the price. And he told us the prices. Back and he said, hey, I tell you what, I'll make it half price because you're in church. And for our first 3 months, we already have a building set up that's really costing us a drop in the bucket of what it would have cost us to go anywhere else in Lehigh. And it's the most popular place in the entire city. So it's been crazy. I could stand here and tell you story after story after story, church after church after church. It's been a blessing, including you guys bringing me in is a blessing in itself. What a joy it is to be here. And there is a few, Pastor Grant did want me to give you a few ways to help, just to give you guys maybe something to think about for the future. There is some different needs that we have as a ministry. And the first is a canvassing need. On three different days, September the 28th, the 29th, and the 30th, that's just before our opening day. Our opening day is October 1st. So the Saturday, the Friday, and the Thursday before that, we're going to pass out 25,000 door hangers. And that's a lot of door hangers. So we're hoping that as many people as possible could come out for either one of those 3 days or all three of the days. If you don't have work those 3 days, I would encourage you. I'll be there with you. And I can set up, I told Pastor Gritton, I'm going to be giving you guys flyers for those days so you'll know the time and the place to meet. But it will be 9 a.m. every morning those 3 days. We'll be going for as long as people can go. Some people can only go till lunch, and some people can go all day. So it just depends on your capabilities. But we have a lot of flyers to pass out those days, and we want to make sure every home in the entire Lehigh gets a flyer on their door and a packet in their mail. So we're praying that the Lord would give us enough people that we could get out all those flyers in 3 days. So if you can help in that aspect, that would be a tremendous blessing. The second aspect is giving. Obviously, it's hard for a guest to talk about giving, but if there's something. Encouraging to me because it shows me that they trust me, which I don't know if I deserve that trust, but I appreciate it. But one thing we want to do is we want to invite all the churches to get behind this send-off service, and we're going to make it a very big deal. We're going to have a special meal that we provide for you. Olive Garden is going to be catered in from Tri-City Baptist Church. They're going to bring it and give it to all the guests, and it's also going to be my ordination. So I encourage everybody, if you can attend that, that's August 26th. And excited about the church plan. There's a lot of things there's a lot of things that are exciting but also nerve-wracking about being a pastor. And I'll be honest with you, I'll be transparent. You don't understand the difficulty that it is on a pastor until you stand up in front of people and you realize that what you preach and what you teach and what you say has an impact each and every day on the lives of people. And you say the wrong thing and it can ruin their life, literally. And you say the right thing and it can make their life a whole lot better. That's a big responsibility, so I do ask that you pray for me in the endeavor that I'd stay close to the Word of God, the Word of God would stay close to me. And as we open up the Word of God tonight, I will ask a word of prayer and we'll get into Psalms chapter 73 together. Dear Father, I thank you for the ability that I have to be able to proclaim the Word of God. I thank you, dear God, that you've given me the great assignment of planting an independent Baptist church, a church, dear Lord, that will be maybe free of Tri-City, but not free of your holy word. And as we stand behind your truth tonight, and as I proclaim your word from Psalm, I pray that you would speak through me and use me as your vessel, that the things that I say would be honest and sincere, and that they would be in the right context and with the right mindset. Help us, dear Lord, as vessels that are listening, that we would be attentive to the words, our hearts would be convicted by the Holy Spirit of God, that we would change our lives, dear Lord, for the better from tonight and on throughout our week. In Jesus' name we pray all these things. Amen and amen. Psalm chapter 73 is kind of an interesting portion of Scripture. For what I'm doing most of the time, I was thinking about different sermons I could present. And normally you would go to a place that talks about what you're doing. Maybe you'd run to the charge of planting a church, or the importance of a New Testament church. There's a lot of different sermons you could talk about. But lately, the Lord's really been striking my heart on this chapter of Scripture. And we open the chapter. The chapter is really dealing with the envying of sinners. And the chapter starts in verse 1, a Psalm of Asaph. And verse 1 says, "Truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. For I was envious of the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there were no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. Therefore, pride can cast them about as a chain, violence covereth them as a garment. Their eyes stand out with fatness, they have no more than heart could wish." Verse 8 says, "They are corrupt and speak lofty concerning," or speak wickedly concerning the oppression, they speak loftily. Verse 9, "They set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue walketh through the earth." Verse 10 says, "Therefore his people return hither, and waters of full cup are wrung out to them. And they say, How doth God know, and is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world, they increase in riches. Verily I have cleansed my heart in vain, and washed my hands in innocency. For all the day long I have been plagued and chastened every morning. If I say I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of thy children. When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me. Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I their end. Surely thou didst set them in slippery places, thou castest them down into destruction. How are they brought into desolation as in a moment? They are utterly consumed with terrors. As a dream when one awakest, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise their image. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked in my reins. So foolish was I and ignorant, I was a beast before thee." Verse 23 says, "Nevertheless, I am continually with thee. Thou hast holden me by thy right hand. Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterwards receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but thee, and there is none upon the earth that I desire besides thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart, and my portion forever. For lo, they that are far from thee shall perish. Thou hast destroyed all them that go a-whoring from thee." Verse 28 says, "But it is good for me to draw nigh to God, or draw near to God, but I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all thy works." What a passage of Scripture. And it really is a heart-searching thing when we look at Psalms chapter 73. The passage is really all about envying sinners. In a Psalm of Asaph, Asaph was David's song leader, as it were. He was the lead man when it came to the creation of the Psalms. Possibly wrote music to them, but also helped pen words as well. And you find other places in Scripture. We'll talk about Asaph's writings of different psalms and things like that in the book of Chronicles. But it's very interesting that you have such a man that's so close to God, such a man that is like us today, somebody who was always near David, always near the king, always helping pin the words, helping pin the music to psalms like, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good," yet he himself is going to go through a time of testing in his life. A man who, as you would think, would never falter, who would never go through an issue, who would never have a depressing day, is about to vent for 14 verses on how he can't understand God. And we come to this passage of Scripture. J. Vernon McGee, when talking about this portion of Scripture in one of his commentaries, had mentioned that it didn't become real to him until his baby girl was born at the hospital. And J. Vernon McGee will tell you a story about how his baby girl was born, and just a day later, while still in the hospital, that baby girl died. And he said, I couldn't understand it. The people across the hall from him, he knew vaguely from the past. And they were a rich couple who had friends over and were celebrating with their alcohol and all this party of a time. And he said he had to go out into the porch and really plead to God to ask him, why are the good things happening to the bad people? And why would you take my little girl from me? It became real to him. He had an issue that happened in his life that was a turning point to wonder, why does this happen? Why do bad things seem to happen to the good and good things to happen to the bad? Asaph is going to show us in this passage of Scripture three different things that we could outline, or we could divide the chapter into Asaph's anchor, found in verse number 1. He says, truly God is good to Israel. And we stop there and we say there's an anchor placed even before his time of venting, even before his time of anger, as it will, or his frustration. He anchors in the fact that God is good. And that's something that all of us have to do in our lives. If we ever want to make it through our hardships, you need to start with the basis that God is good. Because if you don't, there's no way you're going to get through your hardship thinking God's still doing bad to you. Asaph had an anchor in his mind that he said, I know I don't understand what's happening and I'm upset, but I still know God is good. And we all need in our minds settle that fact once and for all that God is God and God is always good. Now, the verse does say, and I won't lie to you, it does say that he's good to those that are of a clean heart. The Bible's very assuring that God is good to the people that are good. It doesn't always mean that the rain won't fall on the just and the unjust. The Bible says that. But it does mean that the Word of God teaches that one that is holy or dedicated to God has God's favor on their life. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. We know the verse. I won't have you turn there. We know that all things work together for good. We always quote that verse. But the end of the verse is more important, really, than the beginning. To those that love God, to those that are called according to his purpose. See, the Bible teaches that the wrath of God is upon the unsaved. So therefore, God's love is upon us who have partaken in his holy gift of salvation. So God's love is towards us. The Lord is not... The Lord knoweth, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. 1 Corinthians 10:13 tells us that God will not allow us to be tempted above that we are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape. So we get the idea God is good always to the believer who wants to be good toward God. So we need to anchor in that fact. We need to make sure that we understand that because when a trial comes in our life, and I'll be honest, it comes in all of our lives. If a trial has not come in your life yet, you have not been saved long enough where you're not serving the Lord enough. It will happen. The Bible promises that. All the righteous will suffer persecution. But interesting here, Asaph, the same man who wrote Psalm chapter 30, or helped write the music to Psalm chapter 34, "O taste and see that the Lord is good," is the same man here that's going to go through this time. He anchors in the fact that God is good, but then he goes on in verse number 2 to say this, "But as for me, my feet were almost gone." As for me, my feet were almost gone. Charles Spurgeon, on this portion of Scripture, quoted how sad it is that a Christian would ever envy. Envying is lusting or desiring, being jealous of a sinful appetite or of a sinful pleasure. Charles Spurgeon went on to say it's even more sad that in this context of Scripture, it wasn't just that he was envious, But it was that he was envious at the foolish. The person that was in the most wickedness, the person that openly defied God, the person that's obviously not even close to where they need to be, they're on the complete opposite side. The atheist who enjoys his sin and has pleasure in it is who Asaph is enjoying or wanting to be a part of. My feet had almost gone, my steps had well nigh slipped, for I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. Now I want you to understand, the second part of this is not only Asaph's, you see, his anchor in verse 1, but the second part of the chapter is going to be Asaph's anguish. In verse number 2, all the way down to verse number 12, he's going to be anguishing, having a depression time here, over the prosperity of the wicked. Verse 4 says, there is no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. Therefore, pride can pass to them about as a chain. Violence covereth them as a garment. Their eyes stand out with fatness. In other words, it's the lust of the eyes. They get whatever they want. They have more than heart could wish. They are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning the oppression. They speak loftily. Verse 9, they set their mouth against the heavens. See the open defiance against God. And their tongue walketh through the earth. Even skip down to verse 11 where it says, and they say, how doth God know, and is there any knowledge in the Most High? The open defiance of the foolish against God. And here Asaph, the man that should be closest to God in our minds, is the one that's saying, I can't believe it. I want to be like them. But when we think about it, and if we're really true with our heart, if we search ourselves, how many times in our life have we desired to be like the foolish? How many times in our life have we come to God with a complaint? Why do they get to watch that and get away with it, but I can't watch that? How many times do we go to God and say, why can't I listen to the music that my flesh likes, but they can't and get away with it? How many times do we go to God and we kind of give him the same thing Asaph did? They're getting away with it, God, but I don't think I can get away with that. And in our heart, there's a little piece of us, or in our flesh, there's a piece of us that desires or longs for what the foolish have. How many times we looked at the car in the neighbor's driveway and think, man, they work on Sundays. Maybe that's the way they got that. It happens. It happens to all of us. How many times have we wondered how the wicked seem to be so prosperous? Asaph's here battling the same thing. And first we notice, in verse as we continue on down, it's from his own reasoning. From his own reasoning, from verse 3, he said, when I saw at the end the prosperity of the wicked. And he lists all these things, the violence and the death and all these different things. In his own reasoning, he decides that the wicked are being prosperous. Now, we have to be very cautious about our own reasoning. For if you dabble in your own reasoning long enough, you will come away with some very depressing thoughts. When you start thinking that a Lamborghini is the way that God blesses every person, you're going to be very depressed that you're not blessed. And I'm not blessed. If I thought a Ferrari or a Hummer or something, you might have one of those. But it doesn't mean that everybody that's blessed by God has one. Your own reasoning will set off your whole course of life. Why don't I have more money like that person has? Why is it that they don't have the pains that I have? Why is it that they don't seem to die when they do that sin? Why is it that they don't? And you start going with your own reasoning and not God's reasoning, and you're going to get away from the truth of God's word. You're going to be depressed like Asaph was. We've all been there. We have this reasoning here. The reasoning, the most cautious thing about human reasoning is it leads to resentment. Notice verse number 13, verily I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. Notice verse 14, for all day long I have been plagued and chastened every morning. Your human reasoning will lead you to a resentment against God. And whether you want to admit it or not, even though you still have your anchor in God, even though you say God is still good, when you start going down the line of human reasoning, it leads you to a place of resentment against God because you have not been blessed like others have been blessed in your mind. And when you start thinking, why does God do certain things for certain people and not for me, it leads you to this thing like Asaph said, I've washed my hands in vain and I've cleansed my heart. I've lived holy and right for God, and what does he do? He chastens me for it. It's a misunderstanding. His reasoning has led him into a resentment against God. I find it interesting, verse 15 and 16, which we won't get into tonight, he has a restraint here. He says, if I would speak thus, I should offend against the generation of thy children. It's an interesting study to do. There's something very wrong with offending somebody that's young in the faith or young that would take what you say in the wrong way. And Asaph says, I knew I was going to speak it to other people and tell them how I dislike God, but I decided to hold my mouth. That was the right thing to do, because it would have made the younger generation falter from God. And then he goes into this famous verse 17, until I went into the sanctuary of God, then I understood their end. I wonder, and this is just a personal, the Bible doesn't say it, so don't look for it in there. I wonder how long of time there was between verse 16 and verse 17. How long of time there was before he went to the sanctuary. You know what's sad? Even in today, usually coming to the house of the Lord or coming to the Word of God is always put second to everything else. They say, well, I'm really struggling with these areas. I'm struggling with depression. I'm struggling with the devil's really fighting me in this. Well, when was the last time you went to church? Well, I'm really struggling with this, this, and this, and my family's about to fall apart. Well, why don't you come to more services? Why don't you go to the pastor? Why don't you read the Word of God? We always put spiritual things in second place and put our priorities in first place. Asaph said, the only way I got this help, the only way I got out of my depressive state is by going into the sanctuary. The sanctuary in the Old Testament was the place where God met with man. It was a place of the tabernacle at once and then the temple. Well, believe it or not, today our sanctuary, the place where God meets with us in our personal hearts, is one, but also in the house of God, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I will be in the midst, the Bible says. The gates of hell cannot prevail against the church. The church is the pillar and the ground of the truth. So again, what we need, our desperate need, is to make sure that we're staying close with God. And when we get to the place of questioning God, don't go far from Him. How long did Asaph wait before he came back to the Word of God to say, God, how can I correct this area of misunderstanding in my mind? I wonder how long it took him. I also am interested, and this is just assumption again, what he heard when he came into the sanctuary. Oftentimes, they would sing songs around the sanctuary, so I hear and read about. They would sing the Psalms, and some of the ones he very pinned the music to. I would wonder if he came in and maybe Psalms 34 was being sung in the background. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. He's good to all those that love Him and follow Him. You read through that psalm and you wonder if maybe he walked in and he's hearing his own art, his own workmanship, and thinking, that's exactly what I need. And then he hears the Word of God read, because in the sanctuary they would openly read the Word of God. And as they read the Word of God, I wonder if they read some Old Testament passages that talk about how good God is. And going through the Exodus of how God led the children of Israel out of these dark lands and all this. See, he had a misunderstanding, and the sanctuary is going to fix all of it. We come into this place, and I don't have time to go into each one of these, but read these last few verses. Surely thou, notice the revelation he receives here in verse 18. Surely, as he comes to the sanctuary, surely thou didst set them in slippery places, thou castest them down into destruction. He later in the next verse says they are in desolation. Even in the next verse, they're despised by God. Thus my heart, verse 21, was grieved, and I was pricked in my reins. So foolish was I and ignorant. I was as a beast before thee. Nevertheless, I am continually with thee. Thou hast holden me by thy right hand. What an interesting passage of conviction after his revelation. After it was revealed to him of the problem with the wicked, that the wrath of God abides upon them, that they have no blessings with God, he falls under conviction of, why would I be envious at them when they have nothing? Yeah, sure, they have the famous cars, and they have the life of sin, and they have the pleasures that go along with it that only last for a season, the Bible says. But Asaph here is misunderstanding the true value of salvation, the true value of having God. He opens up the next few verses to say, thou shalt guide me, verse 24, by thy counsel, and afterwards receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there was none upon the earth that I would desire beside thee. See, the revelation had come to him to the place where I now see the value of you. I have your counsel, I have an end in heaven, and I have all that I could possibly desire. His whole desire had changed. His draw before was all about, why do they have that? Why do they get away with that sin? And then now it's, my desire is thee. The next verse down, verse 28, but it is good for me to draw nigh to God. And then I have put my trust in the Lord God that I may declare all thy works. It's interesting that that's the exact way that it should work. Your desire changes to God when you repent, and then you draw nigh to him. The Bible says draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to us. You take your steps of repentance, you draw back nigh in reading your word, and he draws nigh to us to give us that reassurance. And then lastly, then we have the ability to declare his works to others. That's the exact way it's supposed to work. The Bible even says that that's what we're called to do. You know, we're famous for quoting Ephesians 2:8-9, that we're saved by grace through faith and not good works, lest any man should boast. But then the next verse, verse 10, is the most important because it says we're saved, we're made in his workmanship, but saved for, you know what the Bible says, good works. That's our purpose. After salvation, it's our purpose that we would declare the good things of God. Let us be very careful to not be like Asaph. Let us make sure we guard ourselves from Satan's temptation in our lives to make us envious at what other people have. Be envious about why isn't God as good to you as to your neighbor? Why does God allow the wicked to get away with these wicked deeds and not you? Why does God convict you about doing some things and not convict other Christians? Don't be envious at the wicked. Rest in the fact that God is going to set it all right one day, which he will. But then you also rest in the fact that where is my desire truly supposed to be placed? Toward God. What's he done for us? Asaph was finally reassured by going into the sanctuary. I know God is good. My anchor's right. Because why? Well, it says it in those two verses we already read. The guidance of God in verse 24, and afterwards you will receive me to glory. The end result is always worth it. When you consider the end, it makes all the rest right. When you consider what's coming, how many times do we read about that in the New Testament? Consider that Jesus Christ is going to come back. Be ready. Be watching. Be ever present. Be ever working. Why? Because it's going to happen soon. You want to be ready, not ashamed, when he returns for us. Let's pray. Dear Father, I thank you for your wonderful love, dear God. And what a sad day it is when Christians, when even I myself have been envious at the foolish. When I myself, dear Lord, have even thought, I wonder why this person gets such a blessing. I wonder why this person has so much financial gain when the righteous don't. Yet we find in your word, dear Lord, we find that you have corrected us. You've given us guidance and light as it comes to going into the sanctuary to receive the instructions. And as we come before you in your holy word, we pray that we'd search our hearts, that you would try us and know us. You'd see if there'd be any wicked way in us, dear Lord, and we would come before a holy God and we would say, God, I need your forgiveness. I've been envious at the foolish. I've been convicted over my area of not appreciating the blessings you've already given me. I pray we would all try ourselves and know ourselves tonight, dear Lord, that you would look in our hearts and convict us for any area of sin that might be in us. In Jesus' name we pray. As heads are still bowed and eyes are still closed, I'll ask you to stand to your feet. The altars are open as the piano plays.